This is how a building without lateral stability behaves under horizontal loads. And this is how it behaves with lateral stability. The concept of lateral stability in buildings is perhaps one of the most critical parts of structural design. If you ever found yourself puzzled by this term, you're not alone. Even in the world of construction, where the phrase lateral stability is thrown around frequently, its true essence might remain a mystery to many. So in this lesson, we will explore different stability systems like bracing walls, cross bracings, truss frames, portal frames, shear walls, cantilever block columns, and understand how engineers employ these systems to ensure our buildings do not collapse. So in simple terms, lateral stability in buildings refers to their capacity to resist horizontal forces like wind and earthquake. Any horizontal force applied to a structure must make its way through the bracing system to the building's foundation. So let's see how structural engineers employ stability system to different types of construction. If you're based in North America, Australia, New Zealand, or even Scandinavia, it's very likely that you live in a timber-framed house. Most of these homes are laterally braced by metal strap cross bracings, plywood bracings, or a combination of both. So these bracings should be evenly distributed and provided in both directions. They should be placed in external walls and where possible at the corners of the building. And the maximum spacing of these bracings is according to the diaphragm requirements, as we have seen in our previous lesson. So a braced wall resists forces which are applied parallel to its length. So bracing A withstand wind from direction A and bracings B from wind direction B. Now let me tell you a quick story before we proceed. We design houses for gust wind speeds, right? So gusts might only last 1 or 2 seconds. So it's a force that happens in a blink of an eye. And there's a study in Australia that shows that 1 in 10 houses might experience the design wind speed during its 50-year life. So as an engineer, you have to design for the worst case scenario, but it might never happen, who knows? So recently I designed a renovation in a house on the top of a hill close to the water, right? So it was an N6 wind classification, very high wind loads, and I could not get the existing tie down and bracings to work, right? The numbers did not stack up on paper at all. That doesn't mean the house will collapse, right? The house is still standing, yes, but it's a risk. And I think you will come across this type of situation in your career as well, where you will have to upgrade bracings and tie down of an old building because they have not been designed properly firsthand. The only annoying part is to explain the client that you have to upgrade all the bracings of his house that's been standing for years, you know? So be aware of these things in your journey, because if you're touching it, it's your responsibility or your boss' responsibility. Nowadays, there is an increasing demand for open floor plans with virtually no walls. Modern houses have a combination of kitchen, dining room, and living room with massive glass windows and doors, which leads us to the next stability system, which is the portal frame. A portal frame system is used in domestic construction where no internal walls can be used, or in buildings that require large open spaces like warehouses, industrial factories, or supermarkets. A portal frame is a rigid frame consisting of columns and beams connected by a moment connection. The critical bending moment happens where the column meets the rafter, reason why engineers specify haunches. Those haunches also help to reduce deflections and create enough depth to facilitate bolted connections. However, the lateral stability provided by portal frames will work only for lateral force acting parallel to the frame. Wind that blows perpendicular to the base is often resisted by steel rod cross bracings. And since rods have virtually no compressive capacity, these elements are designed as tension-only members, which means that rod X works for wind direction X and rod Y works for wind direction Y. And alternative layouts can be used if openings are located in the braced base. So portal frame on residential projects are often much simpler. They consist of PFC columns connected to a PFC beam. The next stability system on the list are shear walls. So think of the plywood bracing walls in domestic construction, but stronger and made of reinforced concrete or block work. They're also strategically placed throughout the building to provide lateral stability and transfers wind and seismic forces to the foundation through bending and shear. And at the same time, these walls can also be subjected to axial forces like from self-weight and loads coming from the floors above. On really tall buildings, shear walls act like a slender cantilever. And in most cases, the walls are part of a lift shaft or stairwell, which form the core of the building and attract lateral loads. Shear walls can also be made of timber, such as in CLT buildings. To finish off this lesson, I'll tell you a couple of more bracing systems that are commonly used in domestic construction, and they're the truss frames, such as K-frame made of hollow sections. We've got also the power truss, which is a lighter truss frame, and they're all typically used in corner walls of less than 600 millimeters of length, where the plywood bracings cannot provide adequate capacity, because plywood bracings, they should be used where you have more than 600 millimeters of space. On patio structure, we can also use cantilever blockwork columns to ensure the lateral stability of the deck structure. Sometimes you're able to transfer the loads to the main house, but if you cannot do that, you can use the blockwork columns. In the next lesson, we will run some numbers and discuss how we can design these stability systems in residential construction. So I'll see you there.